Welcome back to Paul's Tech News. With less than 10 days remaining in Q3, I know most of you have spent the weekend preparing your feasts, incantations, and ritual sacrifices to celebrate tomorrow's autumnal equinox and the passing of a summer where everything went great into a fall where nothing can go wrong. I'm being facetious, of course. The point is, I appreciate you stopping by to get caught up on this past week's tech news, which I have sliced and diced so it can be presented in as palatable a fashion as possible. Thus, our charcuterie board overfloweth with tales of Nvidia buying $5 billion worth of Intel, which has a crazy range of implications, Borderlands 4 generating far too much drama after being out for just over a week, which could have been avoided, and just in time for shopping season, rumblings of price increases for PC components. And let me just check with ChatGPT why that's happening. AI. It's all because of AI, which seems to have replaced alcohol as the cause of and the solution to all of the world's problems. But at least until AI replaces me, we'll proceed with the tech news.
Excellent!
Today's video is brought to you by Thermaltake's View 380 XL Tempered Glass ARGB Mid-Tower Chassis. With an innovative dual-chamber design and angled front intake to direct airflow towards components, keeping even power-hungry high-end PC builds cool while maintaining an unobstructed view. Hey, that's why it's called the View 380. Keep things clean with hidden connector motherboard support, keep cool with four included ARGB fans and multiple radiator mount locations for up to 360mm AIOs, and have fun building with plenty of room for cable management and added storage. For more on the View 380 XLTG ARGB from Thermaltake, click the sponsor link in the video description. It's hard to say what the most surprising thing was about Thursday's big dual announcement from rivals Intel and Nvidia, that they are totally besties now, with Nvidia spotting Intel some much-needed cash by way of a $5 billion negotiated stock purchase that will give Team Green a 4% stake in Team Blue. I heard Lip Bu Tan will be crashing on Jensen's couch for the next few days too, but let's stick to the facts for the moment. Per both companies, this deal, which is still subject to regulatory approval, seals a long-term collaborative commitment that will see Intel building custom x86 CPUs that Nvidia will integrate into its AI infrastructure platforms on the data center side, as well as x86 system-on-chips, or SoCs, that integrate Nvidia RTX GPU chiplets for consumers. So for data centers and AI, where Nvidia already has a massive lead, they'll be able to offer x86 solutions to customers who prefer that over existing ARM-based configurations like Nvidia's Grace Hopper Superchip. So I guess that's not surprising if you're Nvidia and you want to further your stranglehold on that part of the market, but crucial to this combination of x86 CPUs and AI GPUs is NVLink, Nvidia's proprietary interconnect solution, which provides more bandwidth and lower latency than PCI Express. That will be a big question for data center performance, but on the consumer side, there's also warranted optimism for what Intel x86 RTX SoC performance might look like using NVLink between the CPU and GPU chiplets. So I guess the most surprising thing was how surprised most media outlets seemed to be. Barely anyone saw this coming, it seems, which is all the more interesting since it's apparently been in the works for about a year, which means those involved stayed tight-lipped. It also means that this deal doesn't appear to be influenced by the current US administration, and that while no specific products or roadmaps have been announced, we might see the fruit of this collaboration sooner than expected. The remaining questions revolve around existing or upcoming products from these companies that directly compete with each other, like what's going to happen to Intel's discrete Arc GPUs, which directly compete with Nvidia GeForce, and is there any aspect of this deal that will stunt Intel's development of future Arc generations? The initial response seems to be that Arc will continue, which sounds good, but I'd prefer a stronger commitment to future development. Per Intel, their existing roadmap has not changed, and this Nvidia stuff is all additive. I will take a wait and see stance on that, and we will also wait and see if Nvidia adopts Intel's 18A or 14A manufacturing for any of this stuff, and how these products develop, and whether they represent a significant new threat to AMD, as many have suggested. Moving on to the Borderlands 4 situation, which is pretty ridiculous as it has evolved since the game launched just over a week ago. Gameplay reviews by media outlets were generally quite positive when the game debuted, and it seemed like one of the most popular looter-shooter FPS franchises was back on track after the third installment of Borderlands had its share of missteps. But then Steam reviews from actual gamers started out really bad and then eventually showed a mixed result, and negative press has abounded in the following days. There are two reasons why gamers are mad. First, the game seems poorly optimized to say the least, with even high-end GPUs struggling to hit playable frame rates at 1440 or 4K, which effectively bars many gamers without $3,000 plus PCs from enjoying Borderlands 4 without compromising visual quality or leaning quite heavily on upscaling methods like DLSS or using frame generation. The second reason is developer Gearbox's response to gamer frustration. They quickly published a supposed GPU settings guide with no fewer than 68 different configurations, which Hardware Unboxed tested and found to be less than effective, especially given the inconsistencies between GPU generations and what was recommended. Meanwhile, Gearbox CEO Randy Pitchford has been bandying anti-PR statements about, like, Borderlands 4 is a premium game made for premium gamers, or just use DLSS, as if upscaling and frame generation are an excusable band-aid for a AAA title of this caliber. Randy is not known for his PR skills, but almost all his public statements sound both tone-deaf and deceptive, given that the recommended GPUs in the system requirements published way back alongside pre-orders are an RTX 3080 or 6800 XT, which are already expensive GPUs themselves, and which insultingly can barely manage a 45 FPS average, even just at 1080. Not exactly the premium game experience PC gamers are accustomed to. Many have blamed Unreal Engine 5, as there are plenty of pretty games built on that engine that struggle to achieve high frame rates, but there are also examples of UE5 games that are well optimized, such as Split Fiction and Clair Obscur Expedition 33, which both look good and perform well without the need for an RTX 5090. And console gamers have been impacted by Borderlands 4's lack of optimization as well, as what is suspected to be a memory leak can cause console FPS to be cut in half after extended gameplay, a bug that can be reset by restarting the game, thankfully, but that one was so glaring that even Mr. Pitchford said, "Sorry for the friction." That should smooth things over. But don't PC gamers deserve an apology too, Randy? But let us proceed with tech briefs, where the news suffers from shrinkage, what with the weather getting colder and all. I'm always skeptical of news that points towards a price hike right before the yearly buying season, so when TrendForce reported price increases from top storage manufacturers like SanDisk, Micron, and WD this week, I did not just accept the "it's 'cause of AI" reasoning. I mean, sure, AI storage needs are a thing, but it's mighty convenient that all these manufacturers are experiencing unprecedented demand at the same time, as if the whole industry and supply chain was interconnected like some sort of grotesque human centipede. At least this news seems to be mostly talking about enterprise storage, though, but if I know how the interconnected PC hardware industry works, there's going to be a knock-on effect for consumer drives as well. Speaking of a grotesque human centipede, Asus. Their ROG team found that this lengthy GitHub investigation by Zafkek was worth responding to, and if you have an Asus ROG laptop, you might want to take a look too. Especially if your device is plagued by stutters, freezes, and audio crackles, as many have complained about in online forums like Reddit. The deep dive software investigation alleges that a cascade of firmware design failures are the root cause, and includes some super deep cut programming takedowns, like noting that Asus code violates several fundamental principles of firmware and kernel programming. Those are fighting words for sure, and hopefully the end result of this is an eventual fix from Asus. I'll keep an eye out for their follow-ups to this initial statement, acknowledging that an investigation is underway. In other news, why aren't cherries more popular to eat just like as a fruit? Like, why do you only see them on top of ice cream sundaes 99% of the time? Getting back to topics calling back to the headline news today, Intel does in fact seem to be proceeding with the Arc Battlemage 700 class GPU launch, though an official announcement is still forthcoming. Thomas Garonski posted a device ID listing that appears to be for an Arc B770 using the BMG G31 GPU with 16 gigs of VRAM attached. This seems to confirm rumors from the past couple weeks that were derived from shipping manifest entries, and the launch is still expected sometime in Q4. But perhaps Intel was a little too distracted getting cozy with Nvidia this week to go ahead and formally announce a product that directly competes with GeForce. Hopefully, we will get B770 and B750 confirmation soon. And speaking of the Intel-Nvidia partnership to make Intel x86 RTX SoCs that will probably power handhelds and laptops and crossover systems, AMD finally has a Strix Halo SoC-based device available in the US, which is up on Indiegogo, available from GPD Game Consoles, starting at $1,450. That's a lot for a gaming handheld, given what sort of desktop hardware you could cobble together for the same amount, so we'll have to see what kind of market there is for such a high-end portable system. It does include 32GB of memory and a 1TB hard drive, but the price will go up to $1,600 once the crowdfunding phase ends. The integrated Radeon 8060Si GPU performs about as well as an RTX 4060, which ain't bad, but clearly some competition would be good for this somewhat new category of device. So perhaps that Nvidia Intel thing was a good idea after all. But I think it's a good idea to wrap up this show. So there you have it, guys, tech news for the weekend. If you liked it, click that like button or leave me a comment down below. While you're down there, all of the articles I talked about today are linked in the video's description if you're interested. And you can also check out my store at paulshardware.net for high quality merchandise like t-shirts, hoodies, beer sets, and more. Subscribing to my channel is always a good call too. Thanks again, everyone, and we'll see you next week.